to Heroes Forge, a Heroes of the Storm podcast.
What is going on, Forgers? Welcome to Season 2, Episode number 64 of Heroes Forge, a community-driven podcast all about Heroes of the Storm. This is your show host, Jeff Reynolds, and I'm here with the co-host of the show, the amazing Kristen Ashton, who is, in honor of Episode number 64, more awesome than the Nintendo 64. Give it up for Kristen, everybody.
Woohoo! And hopefully bringing back more nostalgia than the 64 could ever bring, though I highly doubt that. I know Mario 64 is a game that lives very much in my heart. What about you, Jeff? If you had to choose one Nintendo 64 game that was a defining game of your childhood, which one was it?
Ocarina of Time, for sure, and a close second place would be GoldenEye.
Oh, classic, classic answers. Ours was 60 Mario Kart and Mario Party.
Yeah, Mario Party's a game. Mario Party is a blast too. Yes, lots of nostalgia on tonight's show. Let's bring in a little bit of this past week as we talk about things that have happened in the past. These patch changes came out last Tuesday for the game, and I am loving the UI changes. I'm loving the way the game looks. I mean, they're just updating it more and more, and it's just a ton of fun still.
It really is, and we know they were doing the big Cho'Gall changes, so those are finally here. Probius is with us, and though he has a low win rate, it's fun right now if you've already figured him out, because people don't exactly expect much of you. So if you do well, they don't really know how to counter you yet.
Absolutely. It's the if you do well statement there that really needs to be thought of when you're going into these games, because I've run into some people that are just trying Probius out in a quick match, and it can go pretty poorly too. There are some pretty insane plays that you can play if you actually do play well. I did get to play Probius a while, and not my flavor as I thought in the beginning. I am enjoying Probius, and I think he fits really well into the game, but I think he's got a super hard kit to master. But once you master it, like you said, I've seen some on-point Probius play in some of the quick match games.
Yes, he's a great, great hero to pick up. Like you were saying, provided he fits that niche that you yourself as a player are good at. I mean, Murky, Abathur, Asmodan, all of those kind of specialist heroes, I guess, are very unique in how they play. So they're not really going to gel with everybody. But if it gels with you, you'll be having a great, great time for the next few weeks, I'm thinking.
Absolutely. You're right. People do not know how to counter some of that stuff yet. So it's really cool. Let's talk about Heroes of the Dorm. Everybody's watching it. Everybody's got their brackets built. This thing is really exploding right now. It's crazy fun. If you haven't checked out the website, heroesofthedorm.com, head over to the website over there, and you can see the schedules, when they're going to be casting games live on Facebook Live. They did a bunch of games this weekend for Heroes of the Dorm. And how's your bracket looking, Kristen?
My bracket's looking okay at the moment. So far, there are only two second tiers that I've been entirely eliminated from. However, the rest of them look like they're holding up. I've got some teams that are going to be going on. And in the end, I'm crossing my fingers that UT Arlington, who is the only team to go into these brackets undefeated, manages to get a victory, the one they were denied last year by Arizona. What about you, Jeff? Who are you hoping for, and how's your bracket?
Well, my bracket's looking pretty good. I got 200 points. I'm in, actually, believe it or not, this moment that we record this, I'm in the top 1,000 of people that have made a bracket, which is pretty cool. I know we had talked about it last week, but Kristen had said that if you are in the top 500, you may get some goodies from Blizzard. So battling to get to that top 500 and picking these teams. And really, Kristen and I talked a little bit off stream here about how you gotta pick the right upsets. When you go in and you see these teams and they're all ranked in their, you know, ranking system based off of their off-bracket play, you gotta pick the right upsets in order to really kill it in the bracket. So I have 200 points right now in my bracket, and in the end, I gotta call it for Blizzard's home team, as they're saying, for Irvine to take the whole thing this year. I think they're gonna win, and they're looking good so far.
Irvine is looking very, very wonderful right now. They're a very, very strong team. And if it's not Arlington, go UC.
That's right. And it's really great to watch these casts on Facebook Live. It's a different casting team than we normally see. It definitely has a different feel than the HGC and all of that. I mean, it's got a really cool college feel to it. So I highly recommend going out there and watching some Facebook Live of these Heroes of the Dorm games. And again, you can find that on their website, which is heroesofthedorm.com. What else is going on in your gaming world this week, Kristen?
In the gaming world, Dark Souls continues on, more like Limpsford, bed raggled, beaten, bloody, not sure how you continue forward, but there's something addicting about this game. It's not forgiving. It's a very, very hard, challenging, disturbing world that you're in, but you just can't stop, because that would be admitting defeat, and there is pride tied into eventually defeating that game.
Absolutely. When you get to the end, you can say, I did it. And I know that's a game a lot of people give up on playing, me being one of them. I played it for a while and was like, this is just painfully hard. And so I stopped playing it. But I am super proud of you, Kristen, to continue on with Dark Souls, even though it gets crazy hard. And I know you have a bunch of people watching on your stream that are rooting you on every single time you log into the game. As for me, I've been playing a ton of Heroes, and I'm getting ready for Mass Effect. Are you a big Mass Effect gamer?
Oh, you better believe my nights starting Tuesday have been blocked off. I'm going to be taking over this new Andromeda thing. I'm going to be romancing. Hopefully, Garrus isn't there, so I don't know who I'll be romancing. But I don't know. What about you? Are you taking off of work? That was a common thing back in the day.
No, I'm not. The only game I took off for work last year was for Legion, when the Legion launch came out, because I was really, really excited for that. Believe it or not, I'm not a huge Mass Effect person. I've dabbled in just a tiny little bit of the original games, but my buddy from college is like gung-ho, and he's convinced me. He says, you don't even have to have played the other Mass Effect games. You can get in here and do this and play this one. So I've pre-ordered it. I'm ready to go. I'm gonna, you know, dive into it with him. And I'm excited for it. I'm always excited for a new game. I'm excited to sit down at my PC or at my console and just say, yeah, it's time to drop some serious hours into a new game. It's just it's what gamers live for.
It's true. The encompassing world, and as we like to joke with the entire BioWare series, the advanced dating simulator they present us with, it's just so intoxicating. And I mean, even the weakest games often have some very intriguing and very, very well-told stories. I know Dragon Age 2 wasn't exactly the best BioWare game, but there were still moments in there that were really incredibly done.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm a big fan of some of their other games, too. So lots of games coming out. Lots of Heroes with the new season just starting. Getting your placement matches in. Have you touched the placement matches yet?
No, actually. I just got back from celebrating my second little sister's wedding. So I have not even looked at the placements. But I will do them just to see where I place, and then probably go back to Quick Match, practicing up new heroes to then bring into the team leagues that I've been doing Saturdays.
Yeah, heck yeah. I mean, there's a lot of great stuff happening in this Heroes world, including the forging of this hero tonight, which we are taking it way back, way, way back, past what a lot of people think as Blizzard games. We are going way back, so I gotta say, let's forge.
Let's forge.
Like I said, way back. Kristen, who are we forging this evening on Heroes Forge?
We are forging, Jeff, somebody that you chose that completely took me by surprise. And his name is Jake Badlands from Rock and Roll Racing, a game that was released by Blizzard back in the ripe old age of 1993.
93. That is way back there. And I mean, this is some Lost Vikings. I mean, this is after Lost Vikings, but still, I mean, it's way back in the past of Blizzard's when they had a different name, when they were, you know, working on different types of games. And Rock and Roll Racing is actually something I vividly remember playing, but never tied it together that it was a Blizzard game until I actually went to BlizzCon for the first time. And when I was at BlizzCon and they were talking about heroes that people would like to see in Heroes of the Storm, somebody raised their hand and they're like, yeah, we need a Rock and Roll Racing character. When are we going to have a Rock and Roll Racing character? And I was like, that's not a Blizzard game. And then the guys on the stage were like, oh, well, it's in the works. You know, we're thinking about it. We're talking about it. You know, we want to make sure we bring those classic games and that those classic games have a presence in Heroes of the Storm like the Lost Vikings. And then I did the research and I'm like, wait a minute. It is a Blizzard game.
So you had this game growing up then. And I'm assuming, because what, we would have been about 6 years old when this game first released, right? So the ages 6 through 8, probably this thing encompassed so much time. I mean, was he the character then that you played the most? Do you have a special connection with Jake?
I don't have a special connection with any sort of character. I can't remember the characters that I played. But what I do remember is racing with my friends, racing with my family. And I think we played it even past that because we were all about Super Nintendo, all that stuff. For years and years and years. I mean, even when the newer consoles were coming out, we were still playing Super Nintendo and these Nintendo games and all this stuff. So, I mean, I think I put some serious time into this, and it's a silly, fun game.
You can say that, but it really is an origin game because I tried it. You can find it online. It's just a web page. You can load Rock and Roll Racing and play it in your web browser. You just got to search for it in Google and boom, there it is. And if you try it, it's an early Mario Kart. It's an early Star Wars pod racing. You get to update the cars. You got weapons that you get to drop and, you know, a few tracks to choose from.
Yeah, and how funny, we talked about Mario Kart at the beginning of the show. I mean, this game is literally that. I mean, you're dropping things behind you as you're going off of ramps, you're racing around with other people. The matches are really short. They're like three or four laps going around this thing. And I mean, there's not a whole lot of strategy to it. There's like a lot of just luck and making, you know, saving your weapons for when you need them and stuff like that. I mean, it's definitely something worth playing at least one time.
If only to hear the retro takes on classic rock songs that are used as the music in the background of these races that are raced on different planets across some unknown galaxy.
That just shows you the reach of rock and roll. 8-bit rock and roll. Going out there and doing some serious tunage as you're driving around as these many characters. And as I was doing research, because I really wanted to, I was lucky enough to get enough votes to win this week. So I was doing research on Rock and Roll Racing because they originally had said that they wanted a character from there. And I was like, I don't remember that many, but there are tons of characters. There's like, what, 12 different characters, the evil people, the people that you can race as. I mean, there's a lot of opportunity for Blizzard to, again, make more characters for Heroes of the Storm. They could literally take these characters even out of the car and make them just heroes on the battlefield that walk around like every other hero. I mean, it's crazy.
They could, and there's even one bad guy who looks like Slimer from Ghostbusters. He'd be the second one I'd want to see from this brought in here.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, this being an old school game and in a different, completely different universe, I think there's a little bit of information on Jake Badlands. Kristen, tell everybody what it is, just the simple stuff that we need to know.
Right. Representing planet Xeno Prime, Jake Badlands is a blue-haired, mohawked racer bringing sharp turns and fast driving to defeat evil racers from across the galaxy.
That is what you need to know. That is Jake Badlands right there in one sentence, and he's a one sentence guy. Unless you get in his way, and then no sentences are needed, because he's just gonna blow you up and race right past you. Something really cool that Chad is talking about is that you can actually download this game and Lost Vikings as well as Blackthorn on the Blizzard website. You can just go in there and download it and play it. I recommend it just for a fun time, just to mess around. Maybe you're really bored. You can play Rock and Roll Racing for fun. So that is Jake Badlands. Now what we got to do is, how do we bring this guy to the Nexus? Let's build these kits, and let's start with Kristen's kit. And the first thing we talk about is their role classification in the game, and what are you thinking Jake would be?
Well, initially I was thinking support, because with his boosts to his own character within the game, I was thinking maybe that's something he could give to other people, but it became too similar to Lucio. So during the building, he transitioned from a support into a specialist.
Ooh, interesting. A really different direction than what I went, so I can't wait to hear it. Okay, what's your trait for him then?
Okay, the first trait, oh my goodness, many traits. The trait is called Car Right, Car Bright. At the start of the game, Jake chooses between one of three cars he can ride around in. One gives you permanent extra speed, one gives you a permanent boost to damage, and one gives you a permanent boost to defense.
Okay, so this is Rock and Roll Racing perfectly. This fits it, because as you know, Kristen, from playing on the web browser, you can pick which vehicle you want to drive in the race that you're about to embark on, and it does just those three things. I mean, in a nutshell.
Exactly. And the best part about choosing the car is this, it's this overblown claw machine grab run by a very evil looking rat man. He's kind of there rubbing his hands together with a very dirty smile as you use this claw to determine which car you want to buy.
And who is the rat man? I mean, does anybody know? I mean, maybe he has a name. If you know the name, send it to us. But no one knows this rat man. That is basically, what I'm envisioning is they want you to feel like you're in like a junkyard and you're picking up one of these cars to race. And maybe they're tying that together with having a rat man sell you the car.
I would absolutely believe that, because what's that stereotype that car salesmen usually got during this time period? They were underhanded. They were slimy. They were sneaky. They were rats in clothing. So it would make sense that that would kind of be used.
Absolutely. Okay, what do you think he's mounting? Is Jake going to throw his car on the back of the plain brown horse and ride across the battlefield?
I'm thinking he would not have any other mount except for his car. It would go faster if he had mounted speed, but aside from that, he would stay in his car.
Okay, cool. So you're thinking something like Asmodan, for example. Like, if you, some of the mounts Asmodan can't ride, so when you mount up, it just makes his legs all, like, fiery, and you run a little faster.
Exactly, just like that. So maybe there's smoke coming from the wheels because he's driving so fast across the Nexus at that mount speed, no faster than a horse.
So, yeah, or those really fast speeder bikes. popping wheelies on those speeder bikes. I don't know how those heroes don't fall off. So back to your trait, when you select one of these cars, does it change the look of the car that's in the game, or does it change the paint job, or what are you thinking silhouette-wise?
I'm thinking silhouette, it would change the shape of the car. So if it's extra speed, it would be a very sleek design. Damage, it would probably be not tanky, but not sleek, and then defense would be super tanky.
Okay, cool. So it is going to change the way the car looks, which is really cool and interesting, because that would change the way the hero looks more than just a normal skin on top of it, which I think is really cool. Okay, let's get into some basics here. What's your first basic ability?
All right, first one is called Jakey's Got a Gun. An activating Q, it gives Jake control of the gun that he has on the front of his car, so he can then shoot out bullets that sprays in a V in front of him that then can be moved around during the duration of the ability. So I imagine you can aim the bullets as they're flying, but also you're able to drive the car, very similar to Tychus. So maybe there's a a auto target feature.
Okay, cool. So, like these heroes we know where you're able to move and fire at the same time. Lucio, Tracer, Tychus, those sorts of things.
Exactly.
But it's a V more like Tychus, which is really cool. So, I mean, you're hitting a lot of heroes, and that's probably where you started thinking specialist, right? Because you can, you know, lane or you can merc with that.
Exactly. The lane clear potential would be within this queue.
That's really cool. Okay, what's the W that goes along with it?
Okay, the W is called explosions because Jake has this wonderful thing where when you're racing with him, you can drop little bombs on the racetrack as you're going forward. So this is an homage to that. When pressed, Jake lays down a mine that immediately arms itself, blowing up as soon as it is stepped on. The enemy that stepped on it is dealt the most damage, while those within the vicinity of the explosion receive less, but they still are damaged.
Okay, so not just the person that steps on it, which is cool, and you're dropping it instead of placing it like a Sergeant Hammer mine.
Yes, exactly. So you want to make sure you have pretty good control of your car, because the way I envision it, it would just pop out the back as soon as you hit the button. And it would probably have something around 3 charges. So you could do 3 back-to-back if you wanted.
Ooh, that'd be cool. Like placing Abathur mines in bushes and stuff as Jake's like wheeling around in his car on the lane. I like that a lot. That's really cool. So question about this. So this, is it going to have like an area of effect that is around each one of the mines so that if you step on it, or are you meaning like there are heroes that are in the lane that are going to take damage from it as well?
I'm thinking an area are centered on the mine itself. So if you're not within that vicinity, no damage will happen. But imagine you're clearing a lane, right? And you lay the mine where the sorcerer is with the minions. That could help clear the lane, right? Because the sorcerer is immediately dead. But the other 6 are damaged enough that they can immediately then be wiped out. No problem.
Oh, I like the way you think. And then combined with your Q, you're going around, driving around and doing some damage with that as well. Very neat. What's this E ability you've got?
Okay, E is Speed Demon. As a renowned racer, it should come as no surprise that Jake would have a nitro button. When pressed, jets of flame erupt from the back of his car, burning any nearby and leaving a trail of hot ground that does damage over time to any standing in that area. Jake's car, of course, receives a speed boost that launches him in whatever direction he wants.
Okay, so I'm seeing some combo potential here, because if you drop this Speed Demon, and then behind Speed Demon, you're dropping explosion mines on the ground, and then you actually like whip your car around and start doing your Q ability, you could do some major damage to someone that might be chasing you down.
That's the hope, and I do like the idea that what if you had a getaway ability that hurts somebody who tried to stay behind you. Very similar to Vala's Caltrops, except not as easily dodged if you're up in their space when they decide to activate the escape.
And the fact that you're gonna be taking damage from this Speed Demon from the flames that are coming out of the back of Jake's car, as well as the mine potential here, I mean, you do not want to chase him down.
No, I would imagine it would be kind of, what is it, porcupines. If you mess with them, they'll shoot their quills off at you. And, you know, if you can survive that and go after them, chances are you can probably win the day and eat them as a meal. But they have that explosive potential to get away that could seriously damage somebody who's not paying attention.
Absolutely. And you heard it here, folks, first. Porcupine soup for dinner tonight. Let's move into some heroic abilities. What's your first heroic for Jake?
The first one is called Rocket Man, and I love this idea. Jake upgrades his car with the coolest feature around, giant rockets. When the big red button is pressed, 2 comically sized rockets eject from the sides of his car and lock on to a designated target once fired. They deal massive damage, and once they explode, push back any nearby enemies with the shockwave.
Nice. So do they deal damage to the enemies that get hit with just the shockwave or just like a pushback?
I think it's just a push back, mainly because so much damage is being done to the target being hit with the rocket. I mean, very much like Kael'thas's pyroblast. If you can't dodge it, chances are you're probably going to die.
This is a great combination of a bunch of heroics that we know. We got that Kael'thas one. We're talking triple tap Nova, but we're also talking things like Emerald Wind and being able to displace, you know, heroes and move them off of objectives. Imagine if you activated your Rocket Man on somebody that was trying to collect a tribute or something, and it hit them and pushed their whole team back and gave you the opportunity to get in there and grab it before they could.
That would be amazing. And maybe you could talent into it at level 20 that you increase the range and it adds a stun or something.
So cool. So you have to, it locks on to an enemy. So are you just blindly firing this and then it finds the first enemy and locks onto them? Or are you selecting the enemy and it follows the one you selected?
I'm going with you select the enemy, because then the burden of responsibility of this doing the job it's supposed to do is on you. You can't blame poor targeting or poor design.
Very cool. Love it. That is a really cool idea. What's your second heroic?
The second one is called Space Oddity. Driving into the middle of the fray, Jake does what he thinks to be the most metal thing ever. He sets his car to spin and activates as many attacks as he can. Mines shoot outward in a spiral. Bullets fly far distances all around him, and any that get too close are burned by the flamethrowers, all while heavy metal blares from his boss sound system.
His boss sound system. That is a pro comment there. Okay, so this is basically him just unloading everything that he's got while he's pulling Brodies in the middle of the lane.
Exactly. And he doesn't have to hit Q, W, or E. It automatically starts shooting out mines that fly out in various distances from the car. And then the flames are going. So the bullets are the long range, the mines are the medium range, and then the fire would be the short range.
Wow. So you don't want to be anywhere near this. I mean, you're going to get burned and then shot and then blown up by mines, and he's just going crazy with his boss sound system.
Exactly. So if you want to hold an objective, chances are this is probably your best bet until your team gets there.
Wow, what a great kit. And that could be even be used on like mercenary camps or something. Like imagine you go in and you try to take a boss by yourself and you activate this heroic and you're just giving it all you've got at the same time. And you could probably, you know, do some serious damage if you're right on top of them.
Probably, and who knows, maybe there's even this animation if you're fighting mercenary or bosses where he grabs onto the boss or something and whips the car around the character.
God, it's great. And that's the fun thing about that's the fun thing about Rock and Roll Racers is that there's not a lot to mess with here, so they could really go anywhere with him. And Specialist, after hearing your kit, is definitely a doable thing. So if you had to sum it all up, Kristen, your whole kit, what do you think it would be?
Can't stop the rock.
Can't stop the rock, the 8-bit rock. Gotta love it. Can't stop the rock. All right, but before we get to my build, what we're going to do is we're going to take a second here to give a huge thank you to all of our current patrons, everyone that supports the show. Thank you so much. Rock stars you all are, and you should have your own character in Rock and Roll Racing because you're all rock and roll stars out there. Thank you so much, everyone that supports our show on patreon.com/heroesforge. And if you're listening out there and you don't support the show and you'd like to, you can do that over on that website, patreon.com/heroesforge. Also, a huge thank you to everyone that has given us a 5-star review on iTunes. It helps the show grow immensely. So thank you, everyone. And if you listen to us on iTunes and you like the show, drop us a 5-star review. Make sure you leave your name and a comment so that we can give you a shout out right here at this time on the show next week. Thank you, everyone. All right. Let's get into the second kit of the show here, which is mine. And I'm actually going to go with the Assassin, Jake Badlands.
I think that fits him. I mean, he is the representative of the planet he's from. So clearly he's more awesome than anybody else on Xeno Prime. And I would imagine the fact that he lays mines speaks to his ability to kill people.
Yeah, Xeno Prime, he is the prime member of Xeno Prime out there, you know, driving around being an assassin. And his trait is called Pedal to the Metal. Everyone knows that if you want to win a race, you got to give it all you got. And he never hit the brakes. In Heroes of the Storm, I imagine that Jake Badlands would be able to select one of three cars at the start of the game. This sounds familiar. One that moves faster but has less armor, one that has more armor but moves slower, and one that does more damage but has less armor and moves slower. Once the first talent, I'm calling this, is selected, Jake will never stop moving on the battlefield, unless stunned. He will continue to drive around, and he's just being steered by the player's clicks, so he never stops moving.
Oh my goodness, that would be pretty nice. I mean, to be fair, if you're active in a game, chances are your hero isn't moving, but I like this because it really forces you to stay in the game. So maybe this would be the perfect hero for people who can't stop typing in the middle of a game.
Right, well, you could still take a second and type, but I mean, he's going to just keep on rolling, as the REO Speedwagons say. He's going to keep on rolling out there and just have to be steered. So it's kind of like a Cho'Gall, but you have to steer. If you're a Gall, you don't have to steer. But with this, you have to steer because he's just going to keep on driving. And also, I think it would help players to keep moving during games. That's a huge thing that I try to work on, is just to continuously be moving, because when you're standing still, you're a stationary target and you're easier to hit. So this would make him really hard to hit because I imagine he wouldn't have a ton of armor.
Exactly. And that brings up another point. Movement indicates you have purpose. Well, generally, right? Indicates you have a purpose and you're trying to keep things going. Like with the Murkies, most heroes, you should never be still unless it's toward the end of the game and you've covered the map in your team's color and you're just waiting for the next objective to pop.
Yeah, and with this Jake build, you wouldn't have a choice. You'd be going crazy. And for his mount, first of all, we had a great minds moment back there, Kristen, where we talked about the three different types of cars. I think if they build a rock and roll racer character, that first talent tier has got to be that. And maybe the parts come flying in from the Nexus to build your car or whatever it is, but it's got to be that, right?
It would have to, and that's every racing game ever. I mean, not only rock and roll racing, but like you're saying, Mario Kart, and then even the pod racing game. That was the best part of that game, was getting to build your car and construct it the way you wanted, because you know that's how you play the best you can.
Yeah, absolutely. Unless they go the route of creating three different rock and roll racers, and maybe one of them's the damage one, one of them's the tank one, and one of them's the healing or support one. I don't know, but there's a lot of ways they could go. The mount on my build, I'm calling it the NOS boost. So the front end of the car rears up and fire comes out of the exhaust as you enter your mounted speed. It just says rock and roll racers, right? There's not a whole lot more you need to do when you got fire coming out of the exhaust and, you know, you're flying across the battlefield.
And I love this whole NOS boost thing, right? I mean, I want to say Fast and the Furious is really what brought that into more public eye. But ever since then, it's kind of been this magical button that we've all wanted in our cars.
So that we could press it and go like 150 miles an hour and immediately get a speeding ticket. Okay, let's talk about some basic abilities on the assassin side. The first one is called Heat-Seeking Missiles. Jake selects a player on the battlefield and fires a missile that will quickly move toward the selected character until it makes contact. The contact must be with a hero, and the missile will fly through minions, terrain, and mercenaries. This is a skill shot that doesn't take much skill, and only other aware heroes can soak the damage from these missiles. I was also thinking that it would be possible with the new UI for Jake to select a hero from the top bar and fire a missile at them no matter where they were on the battlefield.
Oh my goodness, so this is triple tap, but even cooler. And also, is it global?
Yeah, now this is what I'm thinking, okay? So in Rock and Roll Racers, there's a missile that you can get where you can shoot whoever's in the lead, like the leader seeker in Mario Kart, right? You just let it go, and you don't even know it's just going to go. So this won't do a huge amount of damage, but I wanted it to be there so that it could be that deny. Somebody's, you know, just about to pick up an objective or something, and you could click on their character icon in the top bar and fire away and hope that that's the character that's trying to pick it up and hope that your missile gets there before they do the objective. Something global, not super powerful to be heroic, but just that deny.
Oh, so you're saying, too, that if you choose the hero's picture in the UI from up above, you don't have to have vision on them.
Right. You just fire away, because you don't have vision on the leader with the leader seeker.
How long is the cooldown on this? Could you keep, I mean, is it short enough you could potentially keep denying an objective if the other team isn't smart enough to stop that hero from trying to keep grabbing it?
No, I think no. I mean, it's going to have a pretty good, strong cooldown because it's pretty powerful to be able to fire something globally like that. It's kind of like a Taronda owl, but you are going to hit a hero.
I like that. Okay, so more of an annoyance than it would be, oh my goodness, my health.
Oh, yeah. More of annoyance than the assassin-ness, because I imagine that he actually leans out of his car with maybe like a gun that he's firing as his ability. Like, the car's weapons are his abilities, where the basic attacks is actually Jake Badlands leaning out the side of the car and shooting his gun at whoever he's attacking.
I love it. I love it. I always hoped that with this, he would use his car to hit people. And that would be, so it would be more of a melee attack. I love it. I love the idea that Jake's, I mean, who's driving? We don't know, but someone's driving.
That's right. Or maybe it's one of those self-driving cars and Jake's just like kicking back, relaxing in the Nexus, watching Heroes of the Dorm or something crazy. Okay, let's get to the second basic ability here. This is called Slip Sauce. So Jake uses his rear weapon to lay down a puddle of slip sauce on the battlefield. Now, before anybody starts making fun of that name, that's actually what it's called in rock and roll racing. It's called slip sauce, which is what we know as oil. This would be similar to the size of one Zagara creep pool, so pretty big. And enemies that enter the slip sauce will continue to move in the direction that they entered it at a 20% faster slip pace until they reach the other side. There can only be one pool of slip sauce on the battlefield at a time, and the pools are only on the field for a short amount of time.
Oh, goodness. So what are you thinking with this one? You put it around an objective so that, I mean, can they stop? Or they just keep going to the other end.
Yeah, you just slide, like as if it was ice, and you had walked on it, and you can't stop yourself from moving. You just slide all the way to the other side. And I'm also thinking that there could be a talent that you could choose later in the game to allow friendly heroes to be affected by this. Because imagine if Jake hit the NOS boost, and he was ahead of you, and dropped the slip sauce on the ground, and then you could slide 20% faster in that right direction.
Oh, that would be so cool. Now, laying this, would you need to be on top of the center like Zagara is with her creep? Or is it kind of you chuck something and it breaks and there's sauce?
It's kind of like James Bond hit the button and from behind your car, oil drops out kind of feel. So that's what I'm thinking. Like it just drops onto the ground in this like area and pools up into like a puddle shape.
Ooh, now what if he drops it on somebody, an enemy hero that's already standing still. Say somebody's already channeling the objective. What happens when he drops this pool on them?
If they move, they will slide in the direction that they move all the way to the end of the puddle.
Gotcha. But if they don't move,
then they'll stay still. Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. So I like this. Because then you would have to use your missiles to interrupt, hopefully scaring them enough that you can then drop the oil. They're already moving, which means they are out of an objective for whatever period of time this is.
Now, one thing that is interesting is that you wouldn't want to drop this oil on the ground if someone was chasing you, because then they could catch up to you faster, right?
That's a good point. And that would be challenging. You would have to unlearn a habit, right? Because we hit the escape button when we're being chased, and this pops out behind you regardless. Yeah.
Yeah, unless you want them to, like, go too far and then get into a place that they don't want to be. I mean, it would take some practice.
Right, and maybe you're close to your towers and you drop the slip sauce right before they turn back around so they're shot into tower range and boom.
Yeah, Butcher, I'm looking at you. I'm looking at you, Butcher. And Draven Desdrin in the chat says that a level 16 augmentation of this could be that he lights it on fire, adding damage over time to the ability. Yeah, that's a great idea.
Now, do we do it with the NOS boost, or do we do it with him chucking a Molotov out of the driver window?
Molotov, that is such a cool idea. Like, you drop the oil, he leans out, he throws a Molotov cocktail, says something stupid, the thing lights up, and then they have to go through it and take some damage, too.
What if he's got a cigar?
No cigars allowed.
Oh, you're right! I take it back. I would never want to offend anybody.
Too soon, Executus. Too soon. Let's get into the third basic here, which is called Jump Jets. In true rock and roll racing fashion, this third ability is Jump Jets. This allows the Jake player to jump off the battlefield and fly over any obstacles that are in his way. This is a combination of Lunara's ultimate and a dwarf toss, but it should have a different feel with Jake constantly moving. Like, you're constantly moving, so if you hit this when you're going the wrong direction, bye-bye, birdie.
Oh! Wait, what do you mean bye-bye? You just fly off the edge of the map and down into the sky surrounding Sky Temple?
No, I just mean that you're going to jump in a direction you may not want to jump into. So you have to make sure you're going the right direction. You might be flustered and, you know, pointed the wrong way and hit the escape button, E, and you just jump and it's not where you want to be.
Fair enough. You launch yourself over the enemies.
Yeah.
Hours into and the gate's not even open yet, but instead of being cool and just waiting for the thing to cool down so you can get back over, you freak out and you're dead. Oh, poor guy.
Yeah, and I imagine that this ability would not, it would feel as if you had quick cast on always. So you couldn't, as soon as you hit E, it would happen. Like, you wouldn't be able to hit E and then have to click again in order for it to jump you. You just hit E and you take off.
I like this. And this thing makes me think of that scene in Men in Black. And if you've never seen Men in Black, there's a little red button that Will Smith is always told by Tommy Lee Jones to never press. But, of course, there's that scene in the movie where he has to press the little red button and the car morphs and two giant jets appear on the back and they take off. So fast they can ride on the ceiling of this tunnel. It defies gravity. So it's like something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you're gonna just take off. I mean, this is straight from rock and roll racing. You can actually, you know, get these jump jets in the game. So I just imagine you can use it as an escape or maybe an engage if you're going in there and you know. Maybe there could be a talent where you could drop the oil from the sky, like, as you're going. That'd be kind of cool.
Oh, gross. Sorry. You could launch any of your abilities from the sky. Well, except jump. You double jump. Maybe you could double jump. But you could also, your bullets from the sky, maybe those go faster because you've got a clearer shot or there's an easier trajectory. I mean, the potential combinations with this.
Yeah, and another awesome question from chat. The direction you're going or the direction you're facing, asking because some heroes have knockbacks. The direction you're facing, I think. So even if you get knocked back from going straight, you just take off and go forward straight the direction that you're facing. So that could be potentially pretty cool for that too.
Oh, that would completely negate the knockback then, because as soon as you're knocked back, you just hit jump jets and boom. You're back where you need to be.
You've jumped jetted out of there. Let's talk about some heroics. The first one I'm calling Monster Truck. This ability turns Jake's chosen car into a monster truck. I used an exclamation point, into a monster truck. The wheels are huge and allows him to run over players on the battlefield. If an enemy hero is hit with this monster truck, they are flattened into a 2D character model and are stunned for a short amount of time. This ability lasts until the timer runs out or Jake is destroyed.
Yes. 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 Could you imagine fireworks start going off Sunday, Sunday, Sunday? Monster truck rally! Or that scene from the second Ace Ventura movie when he's in the big truck chasing people down? Yes!
And I really wanted to put something in here that made, that paid an homage to 2D. So I'm like, if you get run over from this, you're going to get flattened into 2D.
I think that's fair, because if you're flattened into 2D, we can understand you're not dead because we've passed into cartoon realm, where death isn't permanent unless you're dipped in that bad weird acid. So I like that idea that they're crushed into 2D, because then you don't feel like you're supposed to be dead. Now, when he's in his monster truck form, is he going faster than normal, or is he going as fast as other characters could run?
He's just at his normal speed, but you could hit the jump jets or something and just come crashing down on somebody and flatten them into 2D. I mean, talk about how satisfying that would feel, jumping over like a bush or something and this monster truck. I mean, like, I don't know, somebody's out there, you know, Taronda or something, picking flowers in the Garden of Terror, you know, and all of a sudden this huge monster truck comes flying over the wall and just smashes her.
Oh, people, I was thinking Dragonshire, right? There's somebody on the pad up top, and you've used their missiles to stun them, and then you come, you're busting trees down, jumps, and then right on top of the objective, and the poor enemy.
Oh, I'm digging the feel of that. And then it gets even better with this second heroic. It's called About to Blow. This is a passive heroic that grants Jake the ability to explode when he is eliminated on the battlefield. He will begin to explode right before he dies. Loudmouth Larry will announce to all players that Jake is about to explode. When he explodes, he deals massive damage to all enemies in the area. I imagine that the area of damage would be huge, maybe the size of like a Hyperion circle around Jake. I mean, this has got to feel heroic. So he's going to be smoking like in Rock and Roll Racers. Then this announcer, known as Loudmouth Larry in the game, who in Rock and Roll Racer says that about the character. He's like, whoa, Jake is about to explode! Like, as you're running around. Every hero would hear that. As soon as you went down, boom.
And it would make sense. He's got NOS boosts. That stuff is explosive, as far as I've come to learn from movies.
From films? From fictional films? That's what I've come to learn about NOS. Yeah, so, I mean, you're just going to explode and do some serious damage.
Yeah, and I like the fact that it's huge. Now, would it deal decreasing damage the further from the epicenter the heroes are that are caught into it, or would it do the same damage throughout the entire area?
I'm thinking it does the same damage throughout the entire area. That's a good question, though. Maybe that's something you talent into, like Super NOS Explosion, and it deals damage, you know, equal to 100% the entire AoE circle.
Oh my goodness, and at this point, level 20, imagine that's a level 20. You just drive your car toward the enemy core, you jump the walls, and you land right there between their keep and the core, and you just explode yourself. How many times would you have to do that in order to beat the enemy team, regardless of objectives being grabbed?
Oh, I don't know. I'm also picturing Kael'thas Living Bomb, or maybe some like DOT from Gul'dan. It's about to kill you and you know you're going to die. So you just pedal to the metal and you jump into like a structure or something and explode and deal damage to everything. I mean, that's a pretty cool feeling. It would be fun.
I like it. And in this one, would you be able to activate it? No, it's passive, so you can't activate it. You have to take a death-dealing blow.
Yeah, and maybe at 20, you could decide to blow yourself up. You know, you could say, I'm going to blow myself up and sacrifice it for the team and do like 1-for-5 kind of thing if you wanted to try it and not be a troll.
Yeah, right. And I mean, the amount of damage it sounds like this thing would be doling out would be worth his death, right? Because the entire enemy team, if you get all 5 of them, their health would just be decimated. And then 4 of your fully healed, fully manned up team jumping in to just lay waste would be beautiful.
Yeah, it'd be a ton of crazy Jake Badlands fun. If I had to sum it all up, it's all about driving like crazy. Pedal to the metal is what I would say. The name of his trait is how you sum this all up.
Beautiful. And it lead foot, right? Because he's always going. He never takes his foot off that gas.
Never does. Just running like a crazy man around the battlefield, leaning out his window with his gun, just shooting down heroes and dealing some basic attack damage. Gotta love it. But before we can call these heroes forged, we have to talk about the best part, which is specialty skins and dance moves. So, Kristen, what is your specialty skin idea?
I have to do the Mad Max guitar guy. In the new Mad Max that happened, the dude that's strapped with his guitar that throws fire, and he's got a harness on, and he's jumping around playing guitar the whole time. Yes.
Yeah, that's really cool. So you're imagining Jake strapped to the front of his car with a guitar.
Exactly. And maybe the guitar is used as the gun, and he throws mines or something instead of the car dropping it.
Did you like that film? Because I really did. I thought it was really good.
Like most things, there were some greats and there were some things that I didn't too much care about it. But all in all, it was a very fun film.
And it just looked cool. I mean, that's one thing you can take from it.
Yes, the visuals were incredible and the costumes were so much fun.
Yeah, they were a lot of work. Okay, my specialty skin over here. I'm going to go with an idea we talked about months ago. Seasonal skins here. So you buy one skin. This is our Heroes Forge idea for a skin thing, Blizzard. I think this would be so cool. Okay,
you take this from us.
This is, you buy the seasonal skin. You say, I'm going to buy the one skin, and it changes throughout the seasons that you play the game. So for Jake Badlands, your seasonal skins would be, in the winter, you'd have an armored Zamboni. So you'd be driving this, you know, Zamboni, which is the car that cleans the ice in hockey rinks. In the summer, you'd be driving one of those duck boats, you know, the ones that have wheels and drive around cities, and then they're amphibious, they go in the water. That's the summer one. In the fall, it would transform into a hearse. So you're driving around a hearse, like, you know, maybe Halloween feel for the fall. And then in the spring, you'd have an armored ice cream truck.
Yes, and you imagine the ice cream is what shoots out some of the bullets or something, right? The ice cream has been outfitted.
Yeah, the rocket.
Really awesome or something.
Yeah, the rocket. So like maybe, you know, it's made of plastic, obviously. So maybe the front part of the cone, like the actual ice cream breaks off from the cone, and that's where a rocket comes out of or something.
Yes. Now, what flavor would this ice cream be?
Strawberry. But you're going to have different variations with colors here. So you buy one skin, you get 4 seasonal skins, and each one of them has 3 different color variations. Again, Blizzard, we're talking to you. We need something like this. That would be so cool. I think we came up with this idea, Kristen, or we had, you know, listeners that were telling us about stuff like this around the Pepe time, when we were talking about Pepe and how there's like a million skins for Pepe. How cool would it be if it changed per season?
Yep, that's exactly what it was. You're right. You have an incredible memory. I knew we had done it before, but I couldn't have been able to say that it was Pepe.
Let's get into dance moves here. My dance move is the low rider. So what's going to happen is the hydraulics of Jake's car are going to bounce the front tires off the ground like a low rider, and Jake sticks his hand out, making a rude gesture at the camera, but it's going to be blurred out by the camera. So you won't be able to see what his hand, like the rude road rage, because, I mean, you need a little bit of road rage, right? So it would be blurred out by the camera so you couldn't see it, but it would just be funny like that.
I love that idea too, because you zoom in with your camera, right? So it would stabler so far back, it looks like you might be able to see what he's doing. But as you zoom in, you get that nice little blur.
That's right. What were you thinking for dance moves?
I was thinking Jake would jump out and he would just slide across his hood a few times.
That's cool. Or what's that game that no one should ever play, where you stop the car at a stoplight and you have to run around the car and see if you can run all the way around before the light turns green and then jump back in your car?
I don't know if ghost riding is that one, but I know ghost riding is when you sit on the hood of your car and you let the car keep moving. Because there's a ghost driving your car, but you're sitting on the hood as it continues forward.
God, as I'm saying mine, I'm like, this is so dangerous. There's nothing more dangerous than this. And then I learned about ghost riding. That's pretty dangerous.
Don't do it, kids. Don't do it unless you are in an open field with no one else around, by yourself, and, you know.
And highly trained as a driving professional, and we do not condone any sort of crazy driving tricks. Including any of the ones we just talked about with Jake Badlands. But Jake Badlands would do those crazy driving tricks because he is a crazy guy. We can say that this hero was forged. Oh, man, so fun. I think Rock and Roll Racers is in our future. I'm telling you, just from that one interview that, you know, I mean, Rock and Roll Racers is something that's near and dear, and we have not had a classic Blizzard character other than the Lost Vikings, so they got to be cooking something up.
It's true, and it's interesting that we hear so many cries from more of the modern heroes when, in reality, it's these classic games that really kind of defined our connection with Blizzard as a company.
Yeah, it started it all, even though I didn't even know. I mean, I was playing this game, didn't even know it was a Blizzard game. They had a different company name and all that stuff from before. So, I mean, it's just cool to think that even back then, I was a Blizzard fan.
Yeah, and that speaks to the timelessness, I guess, of these games that we've played. Sure, the music is a bit laughable nowadays. The graphics aren't top-notch or anything. But I am a firm believer that a great fun game is a great fun game regardless of how old it is.
Totally. And this is definitely something that the fans are talking about, bringing Jake Badlands into Heroes of the Storm, or regardless, a Rock and Roll Racer into Heroes of the Storm, whether it's a named racer or not. People are talking about it all over the place. Head over to heroesfire.com and you can see a ton of different concept builds for Rock and Roll Racers. I mean, there's a ton of cool stuff over there.
It's really, really neat to see what the fans have put out. And fans that really do care about these intellectual properties. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just neat that people even think about this kind of stuff. I mean, and do you think, Kristen, that we would see a Rock and Roll Racer in the game?
I do, especially with Lucio. I think of all of the characters that would be into racing, it would be Lucio and his speed boost. So I think if we were to introduce some sort of racer, it would be okay now. It wouldn't seem too out of place because we have Lucio, who arguably is a character that doesn't quite fit the mold of the fantasy worlds that we've seen so far brought into Heroes.
Yeah, I think they're going to bust open whatever mold people feel like is in place too. I think they're going to just keep on, you know, going with crazier and crazier and crazier stuff. And who knows, maybe Jake Badlands is in the future for the Nexus. That's what I'm thinking. Okay, we're going to call the show there. Kristen, where can people find you and all the awesome stuff you do on the interwebs?
People can find me at Dream Destroyer. That is DRMDESTRYR over at Twitch, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram.
Very cool. Continuing your Dark Souls journey, correct?
We do. Tomorrow morning, 9 a.m. Pacific, we are venturing forth. Hopefully, we're going to take down the Four Kings.
Very cool. What's on the docket after Dark Souls?
After Dark Souls, well, we've got Resident Evil 7. We have Darksiders. We have Five Nights at Freddy's. And quite a few many other games.
It looks like you've got your work cut out for you. The only thing harder than Dark Souls might be getting through all of those games on your stream.
Oh, just a day at a time, right? Just like those fights in Dark Souls, a day at a time.
It could be worse. You could be building spreadsheets, right? You get to play games with a whole bunch of really cool people watching that awesome stream. If you're looking for me, you can find me right here on Heroes Forge. We record the show live every Sunday night at 7 p.m. Pacific on twitch.tv/AmoveTV because we are so honored to be a part of the Amove TV Entertainment and Podcasting Network. For more great esports video game podcasts, you can check out Amove.tv for a ton of awesome content. I mean, that stuff is to live by. It is so good. You can also check out our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/HeroesForge, and check out our website, heroesforge.club. Over on the website, we have the 63 other episodes of this show that we've recorded and a whole bunch of hero builds and ideas over there. It's fun to go back and listen to the episodes of maybe characters that we forged on the show before they were actual characters in the game. Varian, for example, Lucio, for example. Check out those episodes and see what our thoughts were back then in the day. They are a ton of fun. If you'd like to follow the show on Twitter, you can do that. Our handle is @ForgeHeroes, and every week we put these two kits that we build up for a vote, and you can vote for which one of the two kits you think won the episode, and then that person gets to choose which hero is forged next week. Whether Kristen wins or I win, that's who gets to choose. Also, you can find our Patreon site at patreon.com/heroesforge. If you'd like to support the show, head on over there to do that. And a huge thank you to everyone that supports us over there currently. You can download this show on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, or any of your favorite podcasting apps as well. Kristen, final thoughts on Jake Badlands?
I think he's awesome, and thank you for introducing me to this racing game. It really is cool to see origins of a game that I didn't play, but later games most certainly were based off of.
Yeah, and thank you for telling me about the web-based one, and for chat for letting us know that you can download Rock and Roll Racers from Blizzard, from their website, and you could get playing it right now, and you could experience Jake Badlands and all of his awesomeness, as well as the other racers. Thank you so much for listening to the show. We're going to call it there, and we'll see you all in the real world.